Good to go. Tracy,
I'm good.
Good?
All right, good.
Okay. Okay, good evening. Welcome to the Reading Municipal Light Department Board of Commissioners meeting. It's January 31st, 2017, our first meeting of the 2017 calendar year. I'd like to make the following announcement before we begin. This meeting of the Reading Municipal Light Department Board of Commissioners is being broadcast live at the RMLD office here at 230 Ash Street in Reading, Massachusetts. Live broadcasts are available only in Reading due to technology constraints. This meeting is being videotaped for distribution to the community TV stations in North Reading, Wilmington, and Linfield. The RMLD Board of Commissioners recognizes the importance of hearing public comment at the discretion of the chair on items on the official agenda as well as items that are not on the official agenda. We ask that all questions or comments from the public be directed to the chair and that all parties, including members of the RMLD board, act in a professional and courteous manner when addressing the board or responding to comments. Once recognized by the chair, all persons addressing the board shall state their name and address prior to speaking. It's the role of the chair to maintain order in all public comment or ensuing discussion. So again, good evening. I'd like to first acknowledge, and I'll ask Phil Pizzino to make a few comments, and condolence on behalf of the passing of our former commission member, Frederick J. Nemergut. And Phil, I understand you worked with him. And
yeah, Mr. Nemergut was on the committee when I got here in 1987. He served from 1986 to 1989. Fred was a very valuable member on this committee back in the beginning. Learned a lot from him. Fred was actually in the energy field. He dealt with a lot of municipals in his, he worked for, I can remember the right name, Makowski was the name of the, Makowski Associates was the people he worked for. And he worked with a lot of municipal and he knew a lot about energy. He was part of what back in those days we called the Dream Team. Because there were five of us that all brought five different talents to the table. And we all kind of meshed together. So we were nicknamed the Dream Team.
Sounds like the present board.
Or a basketball team.
Yeah, yeah.
And so he was very valuable, and I read recently where he passed away, and I thought we would keep our tradition alive of offering our condolences to former commissioners when they pass away here for and thank him for their service.
Good. So recognized. Thank you, Phil.
Yep.
Dennis Kelly is expected as the Citizens Advisory Board committee member here this evening. He's not yet arrived, so we'll continue, and if he's able to make it, he'll join us. Dave Talbot, will you be the board secretary?
Sure.
This evening? Thank you. So we now will move on to public comment. I don't see anyone that's here for citizens' comments. So
just one thing, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, please.
I did watch the entire meeting, your last entire meeting on Sunday night. Yes, it was a slow night.
Okay. Yeah.
And on the fact that the chairman can't add.
This was not a prerequisite.
It was interesting.
I think we got it right the third time, as I remember.
Yes, yeah. I know.
Yeah. Okay. Good. So, good.
Very good.
Thank you very much, Phil. Mm-hmm. So I don't know that we did not have a committee meeting for the Citizen Advisory in December, so I don't think there's any comment there. So we'll...
I may make a comment
please,
on that. I think
yes.
I did... see that the another person has been appointed to the vacancy spot by the Board of Selectmen, Neil Cohen.
Okay, great.
Who lives here in Reading as
mm-hmm.
well. So.
Okay,
good.
Yep.
Excellent. So that'll be good to have that position filled.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so a couple of comments. First, I wanted to just tie up a loose end. Back in October, some of you may recall, we had received, this is an outcome of the NEPA conference that is held annually, and there was some concern expressed about one of the speakers there who is, I guess you'd, the parlance is climate denier. So it was really a one conversation speaker regarding the climate instead of denying the adverse effects. So we have received a letter in response to some other communications from NEPA and their desire to improve their meetings, but we are having a few of us on the board respond as sort of a final communication about our concerns about the realities of climate change, and that'll be sent out this coming week to address that. So I don't know if there's any other final comments. And
no, just thank you for doing that and supporting that, especially with what's going on in Washington. It's great that we can stand up locally for science and facts.
Okay, good. So next, I wanted to just bring people up to date periodically. Part of the responsibilities of the board is to review the general manager's not only performance, which we completed and handled at our last meeting, but also to discuss other related issues, one of which we bring forward today, and that's the general manager's contract. So Colleen joined us in 2013, and the agreement had some modifications then, but like most agreements, they become a little in need of change due to changes in time and responsibilities and just the realities of life. So with the help of Chris Pollitt, who helps us with some of our attorney legal needs, we've gone through the agreement and made a lot of modifications that really protect the RMLD, as well as Colleen as our general manager. So a lot of the changes are really wording and language clarification, tightening up of the document, but there are a handful of what we might call substantive changes that we're going to vote on in a few minutes, and I would ask Chris Pollitt, since he's been helpful in this process, if he would take a few minutes and summarize what those changes are. Chris?
Yep,
please. So again, this is the proposed changes to our general manager's contract for Colleen.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening, Chris.
So we have worked with Chairman O'Rourke to bring the contract up to date. One of the things that we've done is to improve the clarity and readability of the contract. Those are just some general language changes, not substantive, just to try and tighten the drafting on the contract. Other things that we did do that were substantive, we've added a car allowance for the general manager, or car allowance option, I should say. At the general manager's election, she may elect to receive a car allowance, or she may elect to have a car provided to her by the RMLD at her option. Under the contract, there were certain notice periods that the RMLD board and the general manager had to give each to the other if there was going to be a termination for convenience. As the contract was initially drafted, the general manager had to give the RMLD board 6 months' notice if she was going to leave prior to the end of a contract term. Yet the board could terminate the general manager for convenience upon 30 days' notice. To give the RMLD a little bit more protection and to be fair to the GM, those notice periods have been changed to 60 days each. So if the GM would like to leave for convenience, she needs to give the RMLD 60 days' notice. If the RMLD board would like to let the GM go and move in a different direction, they need to give her 60 days' notice. In our opinion, that's more commonplace and standard in the industry. We have also, in the contract, increased the general manager's ICMA contribution, that is her retirement fund match from the RMLD, from 3% to 4%, which is consistent with benefits that other employees at the RMLD are getting. And the last substantive change, there was under the initial contract, the general manager did have a life insurance benefit equal to 2 times her salary, and that was to be provided by the light department. For a number of reasons, that's turned out to be more difficult than anybody envisioned. Therefore, in lieu of the RMLD providing a policy to Colleen, Colleen will instead receive a $520 per year reimbursement for a policy that she will procure. Did Did the board have any questions on any of the changes?
No.
None appearing. So just a comment by way of explanation. So the board has committees that work on these issues. So we met as a committee earlier this evening, myself and Chairman Stempick and Chairman Talbot, to review these in detail and as a result to move forward to this meeting for general presentation and approval by the board. So let me summarize the changes, and I'll ask for a second. We'll entertain discussion as we normally do, and we'll go for a vote. Okay, so we are going to vote on changes made to the general manager's existing contract that I address the following. Number one, some clarification and readability changes that I would characterize as non-substantive. Secondly, including the car allowance that was voted and approved last year, but also provides for additional compensation for mileage outside of the area if approved by the board. Thirdly, changing the noticing period to 60 days, both for RMLD and for the general manager, for in the event that the either decides to terminate the contract prior to its expiration. Fourth, that we will increase the ICMA contribution to 4% for the general manager to be consistent with the current contribution for other employees at RMLD. And then lastly, the life insurance policy, which is a part of the agreement to cover 2x salary for the general manager, will be handled by compensating Colleen $520 per year for her obtaining a policy on her own. And she'll be responsible for submitting that for expense and required to pay the tax liability related to that.
Okay, so you make the motion, Mr. Chairman? I'll move that we that the board, the commission, accept the changes to the general manager's contract with the changes to incorporate the items of which the chair just delineated.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? Okay, none appearing. We'll go to vote. All in favor, please raise your hand.
Yep.
Okay, so
just for the record, we should make sure that those items that he just mentioned get in the minutes, please.
Yep. Okay. Yep. So motion approved 5-0. Yep. So thank you. And I just want to make a final comment. I think Chris alluded to it as well. So the purpose is to make sure we have a contract that is current and enforceable, and also part of the responsibility of the committee and with help from Chris is to also make sure that it is fair and competitive, so we attract the best talent, which we think we have done mm-hmm. here with Colleen, but also for future general managers, that is fair and consistent, and also is effective for the RMLD, which in turn makes it appropriate and effective for our ratepayers, which is also an important obligation. So
Mr.
I think
Chair,
we'll accomplish that.
Yes, Mr. Chair, I just want to say one thing. Since I was not at the last meeting, occasionally I have to work for a living. I heard all the comments that all the commissioners made for Colleen, and I agree 100% with every single one of them, and I thank you.
Good.
Yes.
Other than my mathematical error, I think you
right.
exercise good judgment. Good. Well, I think that's great. It's good to hear from all the commissioners.
Mm-hmm.
I know we all agree with that, so thank you.
Yep.
Thank you, Phil. Okay, so next we have also a policy committee meeting in Dave Hennessy chairs that, and Dave will report to us on the policy committee.
Thank you. We had a very recent policy committee meeting in which we, Commissioners Pacini, Commissioners Talbot, and I voted to update 6 different policies that are listed here, and the community relations, safety, sexual harassment, violence, and then there was one more. Policy 19, I think that was, I'm not sure what that one was.
Board of Commissioners.
Board of Commissioners.
Board of Commissioners. So five policies that we updated.
6.
So we voted, and now we want to go ahead and vote these.
Yeah. Chris, did you want to
comment any of those, Chris?
So we worked with the general manager and RMLD staff on these five policies to update them. Frequently when policies are drafted, they're drafted with a particular framework of general laws or policies in place, and those tend to change over time. And so we have worked with these policies to update them to current legal standards. And again, when we, anytime we review a document, we work to improve its general readability, you know, its clarity, so that it becomes more easily understandable and enforceable. And that's what we've done.
Good.
Okay. Okay. So we'd like to vote to pass these changes.
Okay. So I'll make a motion.
Yeah.
Motion.
I'll move that we vote to approve policy number 1, 3, 15, 16, 19, as revised, and further with the changes that we made at the committee meeting.
Second.
Any discussion?
Not appearing.
Okay, all in favor?
Mm-hmm. You just took your job.
Oh, sorry. Sorry, Mr. Chairman.
Just
that's fine.
It's a coup.
That's fast. Can't add, I can't speak. Okay, motion carries 500, Tracy, so we record that. Thank you. Thank you, David.
You're welcome.
We do not have any report from the CAB meeting since there wasn't one in December, so we will move on to general manager report. Colleen?
Okay, thank you. First topic is on the Burlington Electric. Due to the security concerns raised by malware being discovered on a Burlington Power laptop, the RMLD wants to assure its customers that we take the threat of cyber attack very seriously.
Excuse me, Colleen, can you just, for the viewers, what was the time frame for that? Do you recall, or was it the end of last year, was it?
Yeah, it was in December.
And this
in
is Burlington, December. Vermont,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, really, Vermont Public Utility.
Public Utility, yeah.
Protections are in place at the RMLD to ensure our system is not compromised.
Okay, fine. Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay, any questions on that?
No. What are the measures?
No. What are our measures?
Yeah.
I would prefer to discuss those in executive
right.
session. Because of being yeah. an electric utility in our cyber security and NERC security compliance measures, I'll be glad to share those.
That was a test of your...
it was of my executive session knowledge. Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
Very good.
My cast.
Yep.
I will add, though, that Mark, the IT... says that, you know, when you hear these things on the radio and stuff like that, you're like, you're aghast. But really, phishing occurs 24/7.
Yeah.
And it's almost a game between some countries to see where they can phish and find a weak link. And
right.
so it happens. When I sat in Mark's office, we had gotten hit every 7 minutes for as long as I sat there.
Yeah.
So
exactly.
I want to bring it into perspective because, you know, when you read stuff in the paper, it's like, oh, God, how could this have happened? This is happening all day, 24/7. And it's how you're structured and your firewalls and how you've put together your security system.
Right.
So just trying to put it in perspective.
Okay, good.
The APPA 2017 legislative rally. We have a number of topics that are occurring right now with the... Clean Energy Standards Act. There's a number of activities that are going on in which we need the force of the major utilities to go down to Washington and stick up for the municipals as these decisions are being made, and to make sure that you know, where we're exempt, should we be exempt, where we should be playing, where things should be distributed fairly between the municipals and the IOUs. There has to be a balance. And so sometimes if it goes one way and the municipals are exempt all the time, it can get out of skew. And we want to make sure that we go down and everyone's being treated fairly for the municipals and to have that type of public support. And so I'm requesting to be able to go to Washington, D.C., February 26th through March 1st with all of the area utility managers to meet with the legislators.
Okay.
I will provide a report at the next meeting of all of the different topics. I think there's more than three or four of them, correct? Yeah.
Yeah.
And let you know where we are. There's a lot of exciting stuff coming down, and sometimes municipals are kind of missed when they make these laws.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You want the motion?
Phil, go ahead, motion, please. Sir.
I'll move that the commission approve the general manager for travel to the APP 2017 legislative rally on February 26th through March 1st, 2017 in Washington, D.C.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? Okay. None appearing. Good vote. All in favor?
Yep.
Since it's not that far away, if I could ask you, if you have any questions or concerns or anything like that, if you can write them down and I'll take them with me, because we probably will have FaceTime with people we don't usually have, and I'm good. Glad to ask any questions that you'd like good. Me to.
Great.
Okay.
Yep.
So just shoot me an email.
Mm-hmm. All right. Okay. So motion carries 500 for legislative rally travel. Thank you.
Now, the art contest award ceremony. I've let everyone know that in one more of our measures to improve efficiencies, we are not going to do the t-shirt contest. We are going to do an art contest. Yeah. And we have received all the artwork, and facilities were so kind to hang it up into the cafeteria. We've done our voting. And Katie over here, who is not our communications manager, but has done an amazing job filling in as the communications manager and the operations assistant for Integrated Resources, has worked diligently with the schools and everything, making this a success so far for such a huge transition. So we're going to be having two different evenings, Thursday, February 9th, mm-hmm. and Thursday, February 16th. So what I yep. would ask is that the commissioners could, you know, talk amongst yourself, and perhaps maybe we could, I mean, obviously everyone's invited, but if you'd like to split that and help me out with the awards. We do have more awards this year. We've provided more opportunities for the children.
Good.
Because we had such a large level of efficiency to go to this program, we were able to give more to the art rooms and the students for awards. So, but I think next year we'll have more lessons learned, and I think we'll make the program a little bit tighter, a little bit more restrictive about the types of information. We'll probably focus more on shredding the peak and things of that nature. In fact, we may have even actually be the ones that go in to do the training.
Good.
So, Colleen, we had a nice calendar when we did the shirt. So, is there will we still have something utilizing the art?
The calendar, correct, Katie? We're still doing the calendar. It's just with the artwork.
We're contemplating that, right?
Okay.
Because we're actually going to keep the artwork. We're historically, we've given the t-shirts back, and
right.
we had nothing to show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We're actually retaining the artwork and going to display it throughout the
okay.
Monday.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right.
If
and
there's an opportunity to do it, I think it's a nice, nice.
Right.
And a lot of the frames throughout the building, the artwork has been faded. And one of the concepts was to recycle the frames to put the artwork in. That doesn't seem to be working. So we will process the frames through Municibid for surplus. I'm sure they will go to a great home and collect some revenue on that, but they're not gonna work for this particular art. And if we were to come up with new paintings and try to frame them, it would just be too costly. And I think the children's artwork, and if we do it nicely and hang it like a coffee shop, I think it will look fantastic. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm not sure the commissioner's pictures would really work.
only if it's dartboard.
Yeah. Maybe we should wear the t-shirts.
Yeah. Or the artwork, yeah.
Or the artwork, yeah.
Okay, anything else, Colin?
Yeah, the RMLD will be holding a lunch and learn on March 22nd with Integrated Resources for peak demand reduction customers. So you're welcome to attend.
When is that again? What's the time for that?
Oh, I'm sorry, March 22nd.
Yep.
Do you have a time?
It's noon.
Here at our
meal. Lunch. Mm-hmm. It's lunch and learn.
Well, nice. So what are you serving? Okay. Good?
Determined.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. And
not that matters.
And my last thing is on my continued dog and pony show, the team made a presentation to the Board of Selectmen in Wilmington on Monday, January 23rd. It was a very lengthy meeting. It was over an hour. And they asked a lot of questions. The dialogue was excellent. And at the end, I came back to pass along a lot of kudos to the rest of our MLD that have been doing such a wonderful job. They're very impressed with all of the new policies and procedures and maintenance work that's being done and the improved communication. Good. So they were quite happy. But, you know, very interested in, you know, like the 2.5 megawatt generator, explaining how, you know, peak shredding, how you create the savings. There was what were you laughing for?
Some key phrases were coined that evening.
Key phrase, yeah, I call.
Remember, this is being broadcast to our neighboring towns, so.
Right, I referred to the 2.5 megawatt generator as the magic button, because it is kind of interesting that when you hit this button and you shred the peak, how much money you save. If you save $196,000, it does seem to be a bit magic, right? But that's what it was coined. But anyways, we had a good time over there, and the next stop is North Reading next week.
Good.
So, and then we have Reading, and then that will be all the town managers, all the selectmen for this year, and then we'll start again in the spring.
So the one you just came from was Linfield?
Wilmington.
Wilmington.
That's great.
Good.
It's very good.
Okay.
What else you have, Colleen?
That's all I have so far.
Okay. Ms. Parento? A power report.
Good evening. I'm here to report on the month of November. November was pretty consistent with historical Novembers. So what we tried to do here is kind of look at a capture of our energy costs, and we compared them November 2016 to November 2015. And from an overall cost perspective, it was pretty flat. However, we did have increased generation from our nuclear plants in 2016, and that was a result of a Seabrook partial refueling outage that occurred in 2015. Our system energy costs, as a result of our laddering and layering strategy, there was more generation in 2016 than in 2015, and those costs actually decreased on an average from $55 per megawatt hour to $50. So again, those were savings that were passed through to our customers. On the renewable side, those were pretty flat with a maybe slight increase in actual generation. We received about 10.4 in 2015, and that went to 10.5. So there was a little less hydro generation, but we actually picked up some projects in wind. So overall, we were flat, and that cost was about flat from $52 to $51. On the spot market, we actually had a decrease in the amount of our purchased. It actually was around 6,300 megawatt hours in 2015, and that was reduced to 2,139 in the spot market. And that was advantageous for the RMLD as well, because cost increased from $45 in 2015 to $66. So the fact that we bought more, bought less, as the price increase was effective from the consumer's standpoint. Our sales overall for the month of November decreased by $2.6 million. And overall, the average cost for the month from an energy perspective was around 4.8 cents. And so that's pretty flat and consistent for our customers.
Jane, just someone listening may have a question, and I've forgotten the timing issue. So. We're doing a November comparison, so is December still finalized?
Correct. Well, as a result of purchase power, that doesn't get settled till very late. Yeah. So that just went to accounting, and they've just finalized it. I think we finished up the deferred fuel calculation, so that was finished maybe yesterday, right. So we were unable to report that to you. But we should have that at our next meeting, and hopefully, because it's at the end of February, we might run into a problem having January closed by that as well.
Okay, good. Thank you. Any other questions for Jane? Jane, are you finished your presentation?
I am.
I do have a, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, please.
I'm just curious. You know, Pilgrim's closing in another couple of years, supposedly. We don't buy from Pilgrim, right?
Correct. Our nuclear entitlements are with Seabrook and Millstone. Mm-hmm.
Do you have any sense, though, despite that we don't buy, what the impact will be on to ratepayers in general? I mean, how does that get filled in regionally?
Yeah, well, I think part of it will be as a result of their capacity auction. Footprint is being built, and that's about a 600 megawatt unit.
What are you referring to?
The footprint, which is the refurbish of the Salem Harbor power plant.
Oh, to become
From coal to natural gas. So based on the capacity auction, they needed 100 megawatts. However, they're building a 600 megawatt plant. So from a capacity standpoint, there will be excess capacity as well as some generation that will come through that. Plants are coming along lines. You know, there's a whole renewable. The state's looking at that.
Long term. I'm just wondering if anybody's done a calculation, if it were to stay open another 10 years. It's licensed until 2032. If it were to stay open beyond, now they're saying they're going to shut it in 2019, I think. If they were to keep it open, how that would affect rates?
I believe it's Entergy that owns that plant.
It is.
Yeah.
It's 600, what is it, 600 or 800 megawatts?
The benefit of the nuclear plants are significant because they're very low cost, and that's one of the things that our entitlements in Seabrook and Millstone, those are going to be, the debt service will be paid off shortly.
Right.
And so I believe those have been relicensed, so our customers will receive the benefit of no longer having to pay the debt service and being able to receive those attributes.
I should know this, but does Entergy own Seabrook?
No, Seabrook is owned by, I believe, Florida Power and Light.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I'm just wondering, like, if it were to close.
I believe Dominion owns Millstone right now.
All right.
But I don't have the answer to your question, Dave, unfortunately.
Just a quick question on the footprint plant, the 600 megawatt.
Correct.
Where will they be getting their gas supplies from? We're already a bit constrained here,
correct.
Right?
We're constrained, and they had to have, I had this, and I don't have it in front of me, John, but there was an interconnection that was made. I believe it was a 3-mile interconnection that they had to tap off. So they have adequate gas supply.
Good.
However, New England is constrained during the winter period, and that will add to the constraint period. This year, we had a winter reliability issue where they prepaid for some oil backing and some LNG, and because of it's been very mild, we haven't had to enact that very much, but we still have quite a bit of winter left.
Thank you.
The fun fact about Pilgrim is that it produces half of all the low or zero carbon energy in the region, or in the Massachusetts. That's it. So we lose that, it's a lot of solar you got to build to.
Jane, how about, I forget the name of the program, but we had recently implemented a solar.
Our solar choice, yes.
Yep.
So the system is up and ready. We're just waiting on some legal work for some tax incentive credit work between the bank and the developer. So unfortunately, that unit, although it's physically ready to interconnect, we can't interconnect till it's all the paperwork has been completed. So currently we're expecting that to come online March 1st.
Okay, do the customers that have signed up, will they get a notification once it
Yes,
turns
we've been
on?
Notifying them via email to just let them know. And, when working with the developer and the banks, they were supposed to meet, I believe, this week, maybe Wednesday, which is...
Tomorrow.
They're supposed to meet tomorrow, so hopefully we'll get some good news. And then if we're able to start it before that, we'll inform them.
Okay, great.
Okay. Can I ask, Mr. Chair, can I ask one more
please.
Unrelated note? It's related on the solar note. So there's a flat roof we have in the building next door, right? And I think we've decided in the past that it can't support anything complicated.
Is that the garage that you're referring to?
So just as a thought exercise, would it be possible to price out, leaving aside whether it can handle the load, just what does it cost to buy panels? To forget about tax credits, forget about hiring developers. What would it cost to just buy the panels, put them up there, and what would the numbers be? Would that be a benefit to us, or would it be a money loser?
We could do the
exercise. Just run the numbers, and then that's be an interesting data point to have for any public entity in the region that might be considering doing something on a flat roof. Because I know you can just kind of sit them there.
Can I add something, please? I just asked Paul, we have some leaks on this roof. So we need some new membrane, and I asked him to look at membrane with solar, and to talk to you about whether or not, we just had someone do solar where the vendor actually replace the roof.
Yeah, that was at the project that we're using for 326 Ballardville. So part of the negotiation with the developer, the customer actually received new roofing because it has to support the solar right. for 20, 25 years.
So right now, before I give it to Jane's group, it's facilities to see if it's feasible mm-hmm. based on the roof. Because you got to remember that mm-hmm. the whole economic development came in.
Right.
And all we've been really doing is replacing a little bit of carpet
right.
and some paint. And we're trying to just be, you know, very careful about how much we spend just in case
got
this
it.
Building changes it.
So the thing I've... The one thing I've seen done, it's not even attached to the roof. It's a plastic frame, and it's weighted down with 4x8 concrete blocks. Mm-hmm. There's no roof insulation involved. If the roof needs to get worked on, you lift up the concrete blocks, you pick up the frame, you fix the roof, and you put it back. It's like, it just sits there. Mm-hmm. So that's why I'm curious what that type of insulation would cost. It doesn't seem that complicated or...
Yeah, we'll run the exercise. I mean, we have contacts, so...
Okay.
We'll have that for the next meeting for you, Dave. Is that...
Great. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Jane, you're dismissed.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jane. Okay, Wendy. Okay. We're going in normal batting order, it looks like. So, Wendy.
I need to sit there. I don't know.
Hamid comes second. They changed the order, huh?
Well, I meant to do that.
Yeah. Hamid's excited to talk to us today. I can see.
You struck out last meeting. We moved you down in the lineup.
Good evening.
Hi, Wendy.
So, as a new manager, I'm noticing the challenges mm-hmm. that Colleen has been facing all along. Mm-hmm. Time. even though I'd like to work in a very quick-paced environment, that just doesn't work. It doesn't happen. So, therefore, we have paper financials in front of us, and I apologize, and I can no longer make promises. So, we're doing the best we can with the transition, and we are revisiting processes and procedures, and we're finding areas to improve efficiency. We have our software company coming in the third week of February to help start the process of building our financials and getting our budget built so we can have all this. Even though we have some preliminary automated financials, they're not where we want them to be. And so you may see different variations of financials until I am happy with them.
So. Wendy, can you remind me, so are we in the middle of or going to be going into a new business systems change? I seem to recall.
We're staying with Cogsdale and Great Plains.
Yep.
But we are trying to use all the modules that comes with the software.
Oh.
And we pay for it. We might as well, get what we pay for.
Yep. Yeah.
So that's what we're doing. So we're trying.
Well, I think we're okay with paper. We struggle sometimes with the iPads, right?
Absolutely. Yep.
Just like Bill Belichick. I've seen Bill Belichick have some problems.
So that's what Cogsdale is going to be helping us with. And I'm not sure exactly the time frame. It depends on what they see, you know, that needs to be done and and how we can get it done with the staff that we have.
Yep.
Okay. So we are doing the best we can, which is why this says draft, because I'm not 100% comfortable with the final. There's nothing significant, but it's just not to my standards.
Sure.
Okay.
Well, we appreciate the heads up.
Yes. So if we look at November, the first page is the balance sheet. And if you look to the second page right away, we jump to cash and $38 million, which is comparable to last year's cash. So I know that was a question at the last meeting about where cash stands, and I don't think I had this information, and it was it's very comparable to last year.
Good.
So we're in the same situation. Overall, receivables are still doing well. We're still in the moratorium right now, so we had to put out our liens and whatnot. So the receivable balances are a little bit higher right now because of that. And payables, once again, it's just a timing. It depends on what's in the queue, how many projects we have going on, and that matter. But everything is a constant flow. Okay. So then, if you look at page 3, it talks about the sales of kilowatt hours, and if we compare it to last year, it tells the picture of what we've been saying all along, that we're down about 16% or 50 million kilowatt hours sold. That makes sense? Yes. Mm-hmm. So hence the rate increase, I guess is what I'm getting at. So then if you go to the page of operating expenses, so I have two different pages there for the operating expenses, so you can look at it two different ways. We have month to month and year to year, and then the second page is our actual year to date with our annual budget and a remaining balance and the percentage of the budget that remains. So clearly it shows that our expenses are higher than last year. So we've been adding to the maintenance, as Hamid's been saying all along, and Colleen, and our operating expenses are up because we had some vacancies and we're starting to fill those. But then if you look at the budget, we're right on budget. We're exactly 58%, which is exactly 5/12 of the year. So we're perfectly on budget. So I think that tells a picture that we're pretty much doing what we said we were going to do. And I don't see any areas that need really highlighting in this moment, but if you have any questions, I'd be happy to take them.
Yeah, I just, I know it's probably a hard thing to predict, so the revenue thing, you know, obviously in most business would be concerning. Do we see that, you know, if we look ahead a few months, I guess this is a toss-off question, because obviously it doesn't necessarily fall in Wendy's area, but do we see anything to offset that, or, you know, if we fast forward to the end of the fiscal year, do we think that's going to be the state of the business down about 16% against last year, or are there some offsets that we can see? And what I'm really sort of driving to is what do we need to be doing as a board and as operating staff to mitigate the effects, because obviously when you have a decline, which we know why, we want to try to offset that in some fashion. Well, maybe it needs some discussion and review.
We're hoping for a cold winter to come fairly quickly.
Yeah.
Mm. It's supposed to have the Farmer's Almanac says major storm second week of February, so we may definitely get a cold snap,
yeah.
and then, you know, if we don't have a mild spring, I mean, we still have some time,
yeah,
left.
Yeah.
You know, could have a very warm spring. I mean, there's a lot of time left to try to recover. I mean, we're,
yeah,
monitoring it.
Yeah.
We're doing a cost of service study. This is the third year, so we're doing a formal cost of service study,
right,
as I admitted to. I'm not really sure I understand what kind of action.
Yeah, and I don't know what there is, I guess.
Other than monitoring it, that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I'm not sure either. I mean, I guess there's a few ways to get it. I mean, eventually it finds its way, of course, to the bottom line. So it's a question of, you know, if revenue continues to decline, do we need to I'm not suggesting that we do. It may force or cause us to rethink our rate of investment, you know, in terms of, you know, infrastructure, although we certainly want to continue. The MEET's got some tremendous programs, but, you know, in the extreme, it's just a case of, you know, the business model. So if it's there, as you said, we don't want to panic. So I guess it's just around, do we see that, you know, declining,
right,
the decrease?
We had, you know, we changed our business model to target closer to what we're allowed to make on the rate of return.
Right.
And we did that in anticipation of, you know, the sales being flat, but the maintenance,
yeah,
you know, the short and long-term plans for both capital and maintenance that were considered critical.
Yeah.
And that's what we're working on. We're staying in that priority range, and we're monitoring it monthly. And at this very point, I don't see that we would take any steps to curtail anything that's still in the priority range.
Yeah, and I certainly would not
if it
either.
It gets to be the end of March, and we've got no winter yet, and all of a sudden the leaves are starting to bloom, and we're still, well, we may make some decisions then, I would think. Does the rest of the team have any other comments?
Tom, I apologize. In my haste, I did not include the revenue in here. I apologize. It is flat, though, so it's not the actual base revenue is not decreased.
Oh, okay. I was just looking at you. Yeah.
I apologize.
Okay.
Because of the rate increase.
Yeah.
Okay. You know,
so that's
in our studies. So yeah. We're where we should be.
Yep.
So.
Okay.
Forgive me for that.
Okay. No, that's fine. I guess just my personal thought is I think that's all I would suggest. We certainly die.
Right.
That was illustrative. I mean, there's only so many finite things you can do. You can grow the top and or cut your expenses, right. But we don't want to undo all the good work because we see it starting to pay off now with infrastructure right. changes. But I guess from a board's perspective, to the extent that we can be helpful, I guess I would do that after we get through the end of March. If things right. look like right. you know they're not yep. going in the right direction, it might be
decisions. Right.
And we also, I don't know if we're going to talk about the meetings. We had talked about a strategy offsite at some point, and that might fold in nicely with that kind of a meeting as well, just around, because that's not a, it's not just a fiscal 2017 issue, right? It's also looking out beyond with
long-term,
all the changes.
Yeah.
That's correct.
Yep.
That's correct. And that rate of return, like we were sitting at a rate of return like a few years ago where it was at 4, we were targeting 4, then not so much, but
yep.
because we readjusted that, we have a little bit more margin there so that at the end of the day, we're still able to make all of our commitments and in lieu of tax payments and
yeah.
whatever. So I feel like we're still on target given that our budget was based on flat.
Yeah.
And you know, Jane's group is going. We got all kinds of programs that are coming in that are mm-hmm. all targeted to try to augment the revenue. And I think it's...
Yeah, and those are some of the, not tonight, those are some of the things that we... When we can have visibility to, because that gives everybody more reassurance that, okay, this is flat, but this is downstream going to, you know, offset that.
Right.
So.
Good. Okay. Good.
Well, Wendy, I just had two questions, if
yes.
I may. One is in the under the assets. In the other category, there was a pretty big increase in the other
yeah.
on the assets. What's that consist of?
That's the, you know what, I have to change the description. I apologize. That's part of the automation that I'm trying to adjust it. That's the deferred inflows of, that's part of that pension liability calculation. That's what that is. I apologize.
I see. Okay, thank
you.
Should
be a better description there.
And then,
thank
you. That's great. And the accrued liabilities, there's a big increase in that as well, about $6 million. What sort of constitutes that?
The accrued liabilities that
I think it's is it the accrued liabilities? Yes, accrued liabilities,
yep.
right?
Yeah.
From 3 to 6, 3 to 9.
You know, I know that, but of course I don't have it in front of me.
Yeah, I'm just looking at the big
yeah.
changes, you know,
right.
in those. That's all.
You're right, and I believe that has also something to do with the pension. But you know, why don't I shoot you an email?
Okay,
to be
that'd
sure
be great.
To let
yeah,
you know.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, perfect.
Good. Okay. Any other questions for Wendy? Okay, good. Thanks, Wendy.
Thank you.
Hamid, you're up now. You're ready to take a swing?
Mm.
All right.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Yes, I'm giving you a report for the month of November 2016. The first slide is showing you the capital improvement projects, line item by item. Basically, that... explains these are the construction-related projects. The second slide is the routine construction. And for the month of November, we spent $134,860. That brings the year total to $754,684. I'd like to mention one thing that you know well. This is only the construction-related capital improvement projects. There are other projects that actually the year to date, up to November, we spent close to $2.4 million. So if you see that... And the line budget items, you know, it's actually we've spent more because there are some projects that they're not showing over here. Under the routine maintenance, we got those seven planned maintenance programs, the transformer replacement. We're making progress. In the Piedmont categories, we changed approximately 24%. In the overhead, we changed approximately 16% of the transformers that they were targeted as being old or aged. For the pole inspection program, we have 204 poles that have been replaced to date. 117 of those transfers have been completed, and we are making progress on those as well. The quarterly inspection of the feeders, those are the list of the feeders that, you know, during that quarter were inspected. As I mentioned before, In a quarterly inspection, we routinely, the crews that are patrolling the lines and seeing, looking for any signs of troubles and anything that, you know, could be detected and could be fixed before it leads to any failure. Manhole inspection program, we have inspected 961 out of the 1,237. During this program also, we've detected some problems that, you know, they've been either fixed or we have a list of those in the priority list to be taken care of, and it's a great program. Porcelain cutout replacements, 91% completed. Tree trimming, we have 188 spans trimmed up to November. That brings the year to date, fiscal year, 564 spans. That's paying off. The substation maintenance programs, we routinely go to the substations every month to detect the hot spots with the infrared, and we haven't found any problems yet since we beefed up the maintenance program. The next slide is the double poles. As you know, there are approximately 16,000 poles in RMLD service territories. The ownership is 50-50 between RMLD and Verizon, but the custodial, we in the Reading, we split with Verizon. North Reading, it's us. Linfield is Verizon, and Wilmington is also Verizon. The next slide is showing to you the engines report, which shows the transfers, double poles, basically in every town. In Linfield, you see RMLD has four transfers to do. North Reading, we got 15 transfers and 58 poles to be pulled out. These are double poles. In Reading, we have 48 transfers to make, and we got 47 double poles that we need to remove those poles after Verizon and Comcast, they do the transfer. In Wilmington, we got 58 transfers, one attachment, and four poles, double poles, and one guying that needs to be removed. The next slide is showing you the reliability indices, SAIDI, KD, and SAIFI. Pretty much we're doing good, very, very good. You see a slight increase in the SAIDI and SAIFI. Because of the bad winter, we've had a number of accidents that we had, motor vehicle accidents that they damaged the poles, and it looks like they're increasing every year. So we're still well below the national marking, but the national average, and a little bit slightly maybe above the regional average. But other than that, the reliability is really great. The next page is showing you the average annual, the average of the 5 years from 2011 to 2016, compared to the year-to-date reliability from January to November in 2016. In the equipment categories, you see that, you know, well, we, as a result of those improvements that, you know, we've been making, equipment failures are shrinking, which means we're going in the right directions, and that's the result of the maintenance. The trees, we still staying the same. We're making progress on those, but you know, the trees, we got lots of the poles. They're located in the heavily treed area in some communities, and although we trimmed them, however, still during the storms, the pine trees, they got shallow roots and they come down and they make heavy damages to the lines, and that contributes to those SAIFI and SAIDIs that you saw in the previous slide. The wildlife has increased a little bit, and even though we have the wildlife guard, still, you know, the animals, they find a way to make their, you know, mission, which is destroying the equipment.
Right.
Other than that, you know, I guess we're pretty much right on the target.
I mean, what,
any questions?
The,
yes, sir.
Yeah, what's the you probably report on this. So what's the process for poles replacement? So do you, I'm sure at some point you've inventoried. What I'm really sort of thinking about is how much influence is there on, let's say, residents reporting in something? Because you obviously don't have, I don't think, cameras on every pole in the served town. So how do you decide which poles get replaced, and how does that get influenced by a customer calls up and says, you know, my neighbor just backed into the
you know, the pole, and it's about to fall down.
But the process is we go by the engines, and, you know, for every town we try to do, you know, to do every town as much as we can,
yeah.
Obviously. If the customers, they're calling, and that's really been there for so long that, you know, for one reason or another, because, you know, we have lots of constructions because of the reliability improvements that we are making, and as a result of those pole inspections. So we have only limited crews. They can only get so much done, but that's part of our routine program that, you know, every week we dedicate a crew or sometimes two to do the transfers and remove the poles in our service territories.
But I mean, is there a way, is it how, I guess part of what I'm thinking about is it useful for, you know, I'm sort of thinking in a manufacturing environment, you sort of measure near misses, you know, so someone sees a,
right.
you know, a ladder that is an accident, so you encourage the employee to call and report that because it's about to be a safety issue. So similarly with poles, I mean, right. you have an inventory of needs, things that could be problems, but then there's a lot of other events that happen that right. you don't have eyes on. So is it helpful right. for the community at large to call and say, gee, RMLD, there's
right.
you may or may not know this? Because
it definitely will, and yeah. we are receiving calls from the customers, actually, and, you know, the ones that are critical,
yep.
and they're located at critical locations. Mm. They call us, and we take care of those. Steve DeFrode has this program pretty much under control.
Yep.
And as a part of the routine patrolling that we do quarterly, as we identify those critical locations, we put them on the priority list, yep. and we get to those first, and then we move on to the next. And if something else comes up, the pole gets hit, and it's like at the corner of the intersection,
yep.
traffic, which is heavily trafficked area, we definitely move that as a priority and take care of those. Yep. And that's how we manage it.
Yep.
But again, we do lots and lots of construction. I'm asking for our valued customers to be patient.
Yeah.
There are lots of constructions going on to improve their reliabilities. Yeah. And with the pole inspections, obviously, you're going to see those double poles probably increasing. But we have them pretty much under control. In other
to the viewing public, if they see something, they should definitely call.
If they give us a call or they, you know, they call this call center,
yep.
I mean, the control center, we definitely would visit those. And then we, if it's a safety issue, that's number one priority for us. We
Good.
Take care of those.
Just one question. Hamid, of the poles that get hit by vehicles,
right.
Are there any that are multiple hits, meaning they
yes.
they get hit multiple times over time?
Right.
Is there anything, should we put jersey barriers up in front of them or something?
It's very interesting. You mentioned that the pole 118 on Main Street in Linfield, that's the one, the Capacitor Bank that we moved, you know, and the same pole got hit again.
Okay.
It's interesting. This is probably the third time it's getting hit.
Right.
So I asked Steve DeFrore to approach the town and get permission to put some type of, you know, barriers.
Yeah, sand barrier or whatever.
Right now there is no barrier, but we could put guardrail because it's a curve.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, at least it could stop that. Hopefully, we are hoping.
Yep.
But I could show you the picture that, you know, we had the barrier and the car somehow is climbing the pole. When they had an accident.
Low rate of speed on that one.
Yeah, right? In front of the car, actually halfway, about 10 feet away, you know, from
the ground.
So somehow the people, they find their way.
Right.
But anyway, yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay.
Any other questions?
No, I think you have a requisition.
Yes, one
yep.
requisition.
Mm-hmm. You on that.
Okay, let me get. I'll move that proposal 2017-31 for fiberglass poles and spare handhole covers be awarded to Irby for $27,704.40 pursuant to Chapter 164, Section 56D on the recommendation of the General Manager.
Second.
Okay. Hamid, would you like
to? So this proposal is really to purchase 40 Shakespeare fiberglass poles and also 20 spare handhold covers. The first time that we went out to bid, they want each pole was approximately, the price was $519. Now it's jumped to $660, $150 increase. The last time we got three codes because, you know, it was under 25,000. But now this time, because at that jump, you know, went over 25,000, so we had to formally go for a bid. Three proposals were received from Wesco, Airby, and Graybars. Graybar was disqualified because they didn't submit their tax compliance certification reform. Wesco and Stuart Airby, they were within $180 difference, but Airby was the lowest total price of both items. So these poles, they're going to remain in stock, and we use them for the areas that, you know, well, either the soil composites are really not the right environment for the wood poles to be set, or the areas that we have guying issues, and, you know, we need to install fiberglass for better reliability. Hmm. So basically that's what it is.
Any other questions for the board? That appeared. We'll go to a vote. All in favor? Okay. Motion carries 500. Thanks, Hamid.
Thank you so much.
Yep. Okay, so we have the art awards. I wonder if people know about it, we'll just capture it to help scheduling. So do any of the board members feel confident they can decide tonight which date is?
I think John and I are going to the 9th with anybody else who wants to join us.
I'm on both nights, but quite frankly.
Okay.
I'm scheduled for both nights.
Okay, and Dave, do you have any sense of what you want to do?
Yeah. Which nights is it again?
The 9th and the 16th. So I guess the 16th would be if you have the ability to make that.
That's not the vacation week, right?
No, that's the following. It's the week before.
Yeah, I can do that.
Okay. And I'll plan on going to both. So do you have that, Tracy? Mm-hmm. So for the 9th, it's Phil, John, Dave Hennessy, and myself, and then Phil, myself, and Dave Talbot for the 16th.
Okay. Yep.
Yep.
Yeah, make sure you post that, make that we're posted. Yeah.
And that's kind of a, is that, I'm trying to remember, Colleen, that's kind of a, for the board members, it's kind of a suit jacket.
Yep.
Right.
Attire,
yep.
Suit jacket.
Right. Casual elegance.
I don't want you wearing your baseball.
T-shirt. And my T-shirt, yeah.
Okay, so the next item is Thursday, February 23rd, is school vacation here in the town. So we need at least three members. So is there anyone that won't be available for that meeting of they know now? Or?
1 second, let me just check.
And then we have the following meeting Thursday, the 30th.
Yep.
So February 23rd, you say?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
It looks good so far for me.
Yeah.
All right. And when are the budget meetings are in April? Yeah.
Okay. And then you said March 30th is the next one?
March 30th, yep. This is the rare Tuesday meeting.
What Tuesday?
Tonight.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know that we've ever had another Tuesday meeting.
March.
So February 23rd, if it, I guess just March confirmed 30th? To... Tracy.
March 30th?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, March 30th is the other one, but
he said today's a Tuesday meeting.
Oh, right.
Yeah, today's
right.
The rare.
Okay.
Budgets in May, okay.
Okay.
Yep. Okay, and what's open for CAB meeting? We need a...
The assistant is currently finalizing a
schedule.
So once I get that, I'll send it.
You'll send it out. Okay, yeah, still being determined. Okay.
The February meeting I may need to do remotely.
We'll set the chair up with your
cardboard.
Sign.
Yeah.
Yep. 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 Appreciate that. We also have, which we don't need to review, some responses to the payroll and accounts payable, rate comparison for January. So is there any other business? Tracy, do you have anything on your list?
Just a couple of things I want to mention.
Yep, Phil.
When I was in Florida, I actually saw a solar canopy over a major parking lot. And until you actually get up, you can't even tell that those solar panels are there.
Interesting.
So if anybody, you know, any commercial person who's got a large parking lot, they look really, it was a major, I can't even remember the name of the company, but it was a major company.
Interesting.
And they looked absolutely fabulous when I was in Florida. The other thing I saw, I actually got to see a charging station, which is interesting.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. There was one in Billerica I saw. It's almost like a gas pump, you know?
Yeah, it is.
You know, very similar to that.
Yeah.
Usually two sides.
I have noticed that they are putting them in some of the major parking lots downtown, which is an interesting.
We're getting ours here, aren't we, Carly?
Yes.
Where's the time for that?
Jane, do you have a timeframe on our charging station out here? Paul McGonigal is rebuilding the parking lot out here. Yep. And so we're going to have a different type of entrance so that we can station the two types of charging stations. So
right.
It's a bit of a process.
Yeah, it was just two poles, and it was really only took up like four spaces, the one I saw in Billerica.
I would say spring.
Yeah.
It'll be done in spring.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So.
Well, can I add one more thing? Just to let everybody know that we're, Hamid and I have put together kind of an update for the fire departments for each of the towns about addressing fires in substations. So we're going to be having a meeting this week and bring everybody up to speed so that all of the fire departments are aware of the types of equipment that we have in there. Because as technology changes, even with solar, I mean, you wouldn't believe how much goes into fire suppression on solar. Because even if you disconnect it, it's still a generator. We want to keep the fire department tied in with all of our new technologies.
To that point, Colleen, if it isn't too much trouble, I wonder, I think it might be interesting for the board if we could get a technology update. So I'm thinking customers that have converted to paperless might be one, if it's measurable, I assume you must have some metrics. But also, you know, we haven't talked about it real recent, but kind of the social media activity. So how much activity are we getting on the Twitter and also the, you know, if you have any ways you measure the mobile app, things like that. So, but anything, I wouldn't want anyone to spend a lot of time creating anything, but just kind of the adoption of some of the technology. And then if you have a thought, we probably should try to, before we get too deep in the year, think about floating some dates out. Maybe Tracy could be helpful with that around the strategy offsite that we talked about. Can't remember when we wanted to do that, if it was sometime in Q1, but just now that January's by, because the way the year falls by, so some dates that might work for you, and then that'll probably be a little longer process to get everybody's calendars done. So we can think about some dates that might work.
Okay, can we have Tracy work with you?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that'd be good.
Tom,
yes, what were you thinking of in terms of, was that a day offsite, a half a day, or what were you sort of thinking in terms of the, just so we can, when we try to plug some dates, did you have an idea in mind whether it would be a four-hour meeting or a longer, or a whole day session, or?
I would think just a half day.
Half day, okay. Okay, good. All right, so Tracy and I will we'll work on that. Yes, Dave.
Just a question, going back to the kilowatt hours, maybe for Jane and Colleen. How unusual is it to see 5 months into the year 16% down on kilowatt usage? Is that very unusual for a year?
With this weather pattern, right?
Yeah, very much weather dependent. And I know, for example, January, I was just looking at some preliminary numbers because it's the last day of the month. Those were up compared to last year.
Oh, they were, because it seemed like a mild January to me.
It was pretty cold, though.
Okay.
And again, it's really dependent. And I can get some statistics on heating degree days and cooling degree days and incorporate that to let you know. But it is really targeted for the summer months and the winter months. And the shoulder months really don't play as big a factor. So as Colleen had mentioned, once we get through, November through February, once we're into March, we'll have a much better picture of the impact overall.
All right. And the summer moves it much more than the winter?
Correct. It's much more summer oriented.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
If I could just add a couple two things, and I apologize for not doing that. We were really recently notified by the DOER that we had submitted a couple applications for energy storage. And the first award the smaller awards came out recently. And RMLD was selected as a recipient for a flow battery study, which we're working with Hamid, and I believe that was $150,000.
Good, nice.
And we're still waiting for the DOER because we submitted 10 different locations for their quick win electric car vehicle storage, which is part of the Volkswagen refund that they have to do. So the states, we're working with the states. And we submitted locations within our service territory that has easily access from the highway, as well as some commercial sites. So we're waiting to hear from that, but they were very well received, and we're hoping to receive some of those grants.
Good.
Congratulations. That's great.
Very good.
Yeah. Great.
Great.
May I have one last thing? Yeah. Relevant to some of this, I mean, I recently acquired a used Nissan Leaf, and I'm now getting a sense of what the charging infrastructure is like. So first of all, it's big for load growth. I think our electric bill's gone up about 15%, but that's very little. You know, it's $20, but it would cost $50 for that much gas. So yeah, it's great for us, and it's also great for load growth. But there is no charging infrastructure around. I mean, we trickle charge at the house, and there's other things at Nissan dealers, but it's really, they're very few and far between. So I think that if we had an infrastructure, you would get people, just on my experience, you would get people coming into town to use it. Yeah, I guess we'd be charging them for it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, a lot of them are free. I don't know. Some of them aren't free, though. Like, they're subsidized.
Tesla stations? Because Tesla's gotten much better at putting, like, their stations in many
different places. It's a different interface.
It's a level three. Yeah.
It's a different, it's its own
custom.
The one that I saw down the parking lot.
Well, it's got two different rates on it, actually.
Yeah.
It's got two. For cars that are non-Teslas,
right. Mm-hmm. Right, the one that I saw in the parking lot, you actually would put your credit card into it.
Yeah, it's a charge point,
yes.
Probably.
Does it yes.
Get you back? But some of the charge points are free.
One of them was a 240 volt, right?
Yep.
Well, they're 66 kilowatt or 33 kilowatt, or the super duper charger, which are, I forget what, but they're DC. Yeah.
Interesting. Okay.
Anyway.
Yep.
I don't know who subsidizes it, because some of them are free. I can scan.
Yeah, a lot of business owners, they use that as part of their marketing.
Okay.
Restaurants, shopping malls, sometimes.
Okay.
In order to entice drivers, they include that.
Okay.
Some businesses.
We have one at work.
Have a benefit for their employees.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
We have other businesses who don't want to just differentiate, so we have pay stations where they actually put in their credit cards.
Okay.
Right.
So either model can work,
mm-hmm.
And it's really up to the owner.
There's going to be a lot of demand for this, I expect.
Great source of revenue.
Yeah, and good source of revenue to fill
right.
With. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Win, win, win.
Okay.
Any other business before we move to adjourn to executive session?
Phil, yep. Will you lead okay. Us in that? I will endeavor. Move that the board go into executive session to discuss the deployment of security personnel or devices or strategy with respect thereto, to consider the purchase of real property, and to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargain, and return to regular session for the sole purpose of adjournment.
Second.
Okay. This
second.
Is a roll call vote. So.
Mr. Pacino, aye.
Mr. Talbot, aye.
Mr. O'Rourke, aye.
Mr. Stempak, aye.
Mr. Hennessy, aye.
Okay. Meeting adjourned.